So today in my video we are going to build a PC which amounts a total to $865, and the build guide will be based on an AMD system and will be a budget system. We'll be having an Nvidia GTX 1660 super graphics card in it. So let's get started with the video. So in today's system we have the AMD Ryzen 5 3600. So this is the third gen Ryzen CPU, which is based on the 7 nanometer architecture. The CPU has a base clock of 3.6 gigahertz and is available on Amazon for $175. It's also available on Newegg for the same price. The CPU is clocked at 3.6 and has a boost of 4.2 GHz. The TDP of the CPU is 65 watts. If you go to the manufacturer's website for the CPU, you can see here that it supports 6 cores and 12 threads, has a support for SMT, which is simultaneous multi-threading, and it's a 65 watt TDP chip. The good thing about the 3000 AMD CPUs is that it supports PCIe Gen 4 in it, so faster data speeds for new PCIe Gen 4 based drives can be obtained using an X570 board. The memory specification for the CPU is supported of 3200 MHz, but as per the testing, the best memory support for the speed is 3600 MHz. So if you can get a memory for 3600 MHz, which we have in our build, it will be optimum for the CPU. Other options you can use instead of using 3600, you can use a 3600X. You can see the specifications. The X category of CPUs are little bit overclocked versions of this 3600. So 3600X is a little bit overclocked version. You can see here that the base is increased to 3.8, so 200 MHz increase in the base and also a 200 MHz increase in boost. This is a 95 watt chip. The TDP is 95 watts, whereas in 3600 the TDP was 6500. And included with is the CPU is a Raid Spire CPU cooler, whereas in the 3600 a Raid Stealth, which is a smaller version of the Spire, was included. The rest of the configuration of the CPU is pretty much same. If you want to go with a previous generation, which can be a budget option for the CPU, you can go with an AMD Ryzen 2600. So here is the Ryzen 2600, you can see. Yeah, here it is. So in this processor, you can see here is that it has 6 cores and 12 threads, which is with respect to the Ryzen 5 3600, it also has 6 cores and 12 threads. The base clock is little bit lower, 200 MHz slower. It has 3.4 GHz of base clock, and the boost clock is also 300 MHz lower, which is 3.9, and the TDP is same. The thing is that this CPU, the 2600, is based upon the 12 nanometer FinFET technology, whereas the 3600 is based on the new technology, that is the 7 nanometer, and it has also included in it a Raid Stealth cooler. So the chipset supported with it is X470 and B450, and the new X570 chipset is not supported by 2600. And you can see here that the PCI version for the CPU is PCIe 3.0. So you can see it here. So next in line in our build guide is the motherboard, which is the MSI B450 Tomahawk Max. The good thing about the Tomahawk Max is it's a budget motherboard and it has a very good layout in it. I can show you the motherboard also. So it is a very good layout motherboard. It is rightly priced, it's around $118, $119 on Newegg and $115 on Amazon. Currently on Amazon it is out of stock, but you can see the motherboard, which is very well priced and it has a good VRM. So overclocking mainstream CPUs will not be an issue on this motherboard, and it also has a free M.2 slot where you can pop in an NVMe drive, and it also has multiple PCI Express slots. The thing to note is that on the B450 chipset, only PCIe 3.0 protocol is compatible, so you cannot include a PCIe Gen 4 drive in it. If you pop in a drive which is a PCIe Gen 4 drive, it will run on the PCIe Gen 3 speeds. And in today's market, no graphics cards are there that run on PCIe Gen 4, so there will be no issue there. No frame rates of any games will be affected while using this motherboard. So it can be a future proofing motherboard which can be compatible with further generations of CPUs also. We'll come to see that in the near future. And the B450 Tomahawk Max has a feature that it has updated BIOS, which supports new Ryzen 3000 CPUs. What it means is that you can pop in the new 3600 chip in it and it will support it on the go. You don't need to require a BIOS update for that. Other option which you can go for is a Gigabyte board, which I have selected here. So this is another option which you can go for. It's a B450 Aorus Elite, and you can see the board here. It is a nicer board as compared to the B450 Tomahawk Max, but the problem is that the BIOS is not updated, and you have to pop in a older generation CPU first, update the BIOS, and then you can use it for the new 3000 CPUs. So first you have to get the BIOS updated, and you can see here that multiple M.2 slots are given. So this M.2 slot has a heatsink cover also on it, and it is also a B450 CPU, sorry, motherboard, and you can see that it has an inbuilt IO shield in it, and the IO is pretty well on this board. So here you can see it. So next in line for the system is our memory, which is the G-Skill RipJaws 5. We have gone for a 8x2K kit, which totals amount to 16 GB, and the memory speed for this kit is 3600. I think the latency for this kit is 18. So what happens if you go for a lower latency? Your memory response is faster. You can go for a CL16 kit, but in our list we have included a CL18 kit, and on Newegg it is priced at $77. You can see here it's a 2x8 kit, which amounts total to 16 GB, and it's a DDR4 3600. As I talked earlier, that 3600 speed is a sweet spot for Ryzen 3000 CPUs, and if you are going for a Ryzen second generation, which is the Ryzen 2600 or 2600X, go for a 3200 or a 3400 MHz kit, because in that CPU's compatibility for a faster 3600 DDR4 RAM is not supported. So going for a older generation of CPUs, you can go for 3200, and going for 3000 series, you can go with a 3600 MHz RAM kit. For storage, I have selected two drives here. One drive is a Western Digital Blue drive, which is a 500 GB drive. It's an M.2 drive, you can see here, but it is based on SATA revision. So it's not an NVMe drive, it's a SATA revision drive, and it has pretty good quality on it. And you can see here it's ample space. You are getting 500 GB of solid state storage on the M.2 based connector. So you are getting an M.2 based connector here for a solid state storage, and it's a good drive. You can see in the packaging that it has a 560 MB/s of read speed and 550 MB/s of write speed, and the IOPS are around 95,000 IOPS. So good drive, a budget drive with from Western Digital, and it's based on the M.2 factor. So, but it is a SATA protocol drive, not an NVMe drive. So it will work on your traditional SATA Rev3 and not on PCIe Gen 3 or NVMe protocol. The next drive in line is I have used is a mechanical drive, because when you have a bigger Steam library, you also need a mechanical drive for your gaming PC. And the mechanical drive I have included is a Seagate Barracuda drive, which is a 2 TB drive and it has a 7200 RPM speed. And getting a mechanical drive for this much amount, like around $50 to $55, is a good option if you have to increase the storage. You can also go with an M.2 NVMe storage drive in future if you want to further upgrade your PC, and you can pop in another drive and it will work for you in the near future also when you are using it with the Ryzen 3000 series CPUs. For the graphic card, I have included a Gigabyte GTX 1660 Super graphic card here, and it's a good card. As you can see, it has a dual cooler on it. I'll show you the image of the graphic card. Here you can see it, it's a twin cooler graphic card, and the IO here is you get three display ports and one HDMI port. It's a very good card for a 1080p gaming, and it boosts up to 1830 megahertz. I can show you the specs also of the GTN 1660 Super Series, and you can see here that it has 1408 CUDA cores in it, and the boost clock for NVIDIA specifications is 1785. So your card is boosting to 1830 for the Gigabyte model, and based on the GPU boost Rev3, what will happen is that if you maintain your thermals and you maintain your power budget, the card will boost further than 1830 megahertz. So it will not restrict itself to 1830, it will boost further as per your thermal headroom and power headroom. And in the Super Series cards, you can see here that the memory speed they are using for GDDR6 memory, and the speed is upgraded to 14 gigabits per second, and the memory amount is 6 gigabytes, which is ample for 1080p gaming. And also you can use this card for medium to low settings of 1440p gaming also. And the memory bandwidth here is 336 gigabytes per second. So it's a good card in my opinion, and if you want to invest further, you want to invest $40 to $50 more, you can go for a 1660 Ti, which is next in line. I'll show you that. The Gigabyte model for the 1660 Ti. It's also a twin cooler graphic card, and the IO ports are same, three display ports and one HDMI port. And you can see here that for this particular model, the boost clock is 1800 megahertz. So when you go for higher core count processor, the boost clocks are little bit lower because you are getting more performance out of your card, because the effective processor count or the CUDA cores are increasing. So cores are increasing, hence you get lower boost clocks. And you can see here that the cores as respect to the 1660 Super are 1408 in 1660 Super and 1536 in the 1660 Ti. So the boost clock for the recommended NVIDIA specification is 770, and you are getting 1800 megahertz. And as I said earlier, that GPU boost 3.0 is supported, which means that as thermal and power headroom will be available, the card will boost further than the 1800 megahertz. And the memory speed is lower, as you can see, then in the Super model you were getting 14 gigabits per second. Here you are getting 12 gigabits per second, and the amount is same. So reduction in memory bandwidth to 288. This card is good for 1080p. You can run all your games in 1080p maximum settings, and you can also go for medium to high settings on 1440p. So if you are gaming in 1440p, you can choose this card. Whereas for the budget option, when you are only going for 1080p gaming, you go with a 1660 Super, and not with the 1660 Ti, because you can invest your $50 to $60 elsewhere to get more storage, a better case, or another tier of CPU. So don't go with a higher card and stick to the 1660 Super if you want to only game at 1080p and not go venture out to 1440p resolution. So in my build guide, the recommendation for case comes out to be another budget option from NZXT, that is the H510. It is an upgraded version as compared to the H500, and it is for $70. You can see the specifications here. It's a closed front case with ample airflow. You can see here in the pictures, and it supports all the three versions, the ATX, Micro ATX, and Mini ITX versions of motherboard. You can see here that it has also has 7 expansion slots at the rear, and it has a power supply shroud at the bottom. So I may go to the manufacturer's website to give you more detailed pictures for the case. Here you see that this is the case, the H510. The difference between the H510 and the H500 is that in H510, in the I/O, you are getting a USB-C Gen 2 port, whereas in the H500, you are getting USB 3.0 Type A ports. So two ports for Type A. Here you get one Type A and Type C. And you can see for in the internal layout, it has good cable management. It has cable management channels at the rear. You can see here, and two SSD trays behind the motherboard. So it has multiple cable tie down points also. Ample space in the front for intake of air. And you can see here, you can pop in three drives, two in the cage and one above it. So three 3.5 drives can be mounted. Air filters are provided at all locations, all the openings. And this is the power supply shroud, and it has ample room for your power supply and cables, so you can also include large power supplies with this case. You can see here in the interior, you get two case fans along with this case, and both of the fans are mounted at the exhaust, but you can pop in one fan in the front for intake, one for intake and one for exhaust, because the system we are building is not having high heat output, so only two fans will work. You can also get a cheap $10 fan, and you can pop in more fans in the front for improved intake. You can mount two fans in the front to either two 120 or two 140 millimeter fans, and you can mount a 120 millimeter at the front, at the top, and at the rear. So here you can see the case from the inside, and it's a cable bar is also included for cable management, so it hide all your cable. Your 24 pin and your PCIe cables, the power cables, it hides those. It has a tempered glass side panel. You can see it's a half height tempered glass, not a full height tempered glass, and a metallic power supply shroud is provided at the bottom. So this is the configuration for your intake fans. You can remove this cover and you can pop in your fans outside the case, which helps in easier cable management and easier mounting of your fans. And dust filters are provided at three locations, one at the rear side, one at the bottom, and one for the power supply. And one dust filter is also provided at the exhaust, so it is only removed from the inside. So one dust filter is also provided in the inside, and here you can see a system that has been built up inside. Clean system will be built up because it has ample room for cable management at the rear. So in this photo you can see the cable bar at the back, which will route your 24 pin and your PCI power cables, and here another cable bar for your 8 pin CPU cable is also included here. And you can also mount the SSD tray in the front. The grilled section in the front above the power supply shroud can be used to mount SSD. And you also have the bottom holes for your front header connections, your HD audio connections, and also the SATA connections for the power SSD. You also have a very big cutout for a CPU cooler, and are cut out for your VGA cables. So PCI cables, power cables can also come out from here, and you can mount it on your graphic card. So the last in line is the Seasonic power supply, which I have included in the system. It is for $65. The Seasonic power supply is of 650 watts, which is ample for your future upgrades. If you want to pop in a higher graphic card or a bigger CPU in it, like 3700X, 3800X, or even the 3950X, the 650 watt power supply will work just fine. You can pop in also in future a 2080 or a 2080 Ti, and this power supply will not be of any problem. And it is a 80 plus bronze certified power supply. The bronze certification means that the power supply is efficient, but not as efficient as the gold power supply. And here you can see it is a non-modular power supply. So the power supply has all the cables. You have enough space in the power supply shroud that you can tuck away all the unused cables. And Seasonic is a very good brand. Seasonic is an OEM producer for manufacturer of all the power supplies. Most of the power supplies, like Corsair's power supplies, Cooler Master power supplies, are provided by Seasonic, and it has a good warranty on it. I think the warranty for the power supply is around 7 to 10 years. It is a good power supply, bronze certified power supply, and it will work just fine. As you can see, for the total wattage of my system amounts around 300 to 310 watts. You can see here, if I edit the part list, you can see that the power supply, yeah, it is around 304. So 650 watts is enough for your build. The power supplies are most efficient at 50% of their load, so you are getting around the 50% mark, so your power supply will be most sufficient there. You can see the power supply curve also, if it's provided on the box. I can show you. No, on this box no such curve is provided, but the power supplies are most efficient at the 50% mark. And here the total system consumption comes out to be 304 watts. This 304 watt is not an ideal consumption. It is a maximum consumption or a high power load when you are providing a artificial benchmark or a synthetic benchmark on it. So when all the CPU and the GPU both are at maximum load, so you will encounter this amount of power consumption, and in that scenario also your power supply will be most efficient. So you go with a 650 watts power supply. And that's all for today, guys. Thanks for watching my video, and you can ask your questions in the comment box. I will surely answer to all your questions. Thank you so much, and have a safe and nice day.